Hey, good morning, everybody. I say everybody because I'm hoping that this is not just our folks. Hopefully you're still inviting people to church. You know that you can do that. You just invite them to the live stream and tell them that you're going to be watching as well. Hopefully it's not just our Pleasant Grove folks, but we've got visitors as well. So we want to welcome you all this morning. So as we have been doing the past few weeks, shake a hand in your house, hug a neck because you can in your house, high five, whatever it is, but also hit the wave button or let us know that you're here this morning in the live stream. That would be fantastic. Just want to very quickly let you know to just keep yourselves aware. Somebody just said hello. We heard the ding. What we want to do is just make sure that you are keeping your eyes open for a special announcement about Easter. We're working on a few things. We're just trying to make sure that those things are working and are going to be flawless, hopefully, so that we can have that ready for Easter and we can in some way other than this come together. So keep looking for a big announcement as far as that goes. We'll be testing all that this week. Just want to remind you to, as far as our offering, we've still continued to have people ask, how can I continue to give? There's two ways you can do that. You can give online. Obviously that's there and available. But if you are okay with, getting out, you can come by the office and, you can just let Tracy buzz you in and, we've got envelopes and things there. You can drop it in the box right inside the door. Or if you're just not even comfortable getting out of your car, if you want to holler at us, probably not holler because we may not hear you, and then you would sit out there for a while and that would be awkward. You could even honk your horn because that we would hear, as long as the train's not going by. But anyway, what you can do is you can send us a text or you can call us and we'll step out real quick and just grab it from you and put it in the box for you. So there are still ways to give in that regard. So just contact us and we will be here at the office, okay? Next, what I want to do, sorry, my brain just stopped. This is weird. I have to, even though we've done this for a few weeks and I've done a bunch of videos, this is still odd. So I'm not used to not having you guys out here as I, again, looked out to the sanctuary, to the pews, and there's nobody in them except a couple of people. I want to share a couple of verses with you, and then I want to pray over our offering. But this morning, what I want to share with you is out of Psalm 121. We're actually going to read the whole thing because it's really short. But it says, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. We will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Don't stress. He's got us. That's the best way that I can sum that up to you this morning is don't stress. He's got you. He's very aware of everything that is going on in your life before this, during this, and after this. He's got you. So just keep that in mind. Go back and read this again. I would encourage you to do that. But Psalm 121. Let's pray for our service and pray for our offering now. Father, we just come to you, and we are so grateful that we're able to shake hands and hug necks and high five and fist bump and all those things that we love to do. Father, we are together because your spirit unites each and every one of us. Father, we're grateful for your Holy Spirit and that connection that we have with him that also binds us. We are grateful that you sent your son Jesus, and because of what he did for us, we have this ability to communicate with you and have this connection with you. So Father, I just want to now just ask that you would be with our service, that you would just allow your presence to go out and connect each and every one of us. Father, I ask that that you would speak to us, that you would open our ears, and that you would open our hearts and make them ready and tender towards us this morning, what you want us to hear. And Father, let it change us. Let it be another piece that molds us and shapes us into the person that you want us to be. Father, I ask that as we sing this morning, that you would find it pleasing, and Father, that that it would just be a sweet fragrance to you. Father, also, as we come to you, we want to ask that you would just bless our offering as it comes in, whether it comes in electronically, and we're grateful for that, or whether it's people just dropping by to hand that check to us. Father, we just, again, we're grateful for that, and we ask that you just bless it, because we still are in the midst of doing your work. Despite everything that is happening and the restrictions and things that are hindering, if you will, Father, your work is not being hindered. Maybe in our mind, things are being hindered in your work, but it's not. And we are grateful for that, because you are God Almighty. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are our maker and creator. And Father, you are the one that is in control. And we are so grateful for that. We come to you in the mighty and awesome name of your Son, Jesus. And we ask that you would just hear us, and that you would be blessed by what we bring to you this morning. And it's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Terry. Never before have I been reminded this is not our world. Amen. This is not our home.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing. But am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not where I belong. Take this world and give me Jesus. This is not where I belong. So when the walls come falling down on me, and when I'm lost in the current of raging sea, I have this blessed assurance. All I know is I'm not home yet. This
I know you're sitting at home right now, but stand up, sing along with us, raise your hand to the Lord. Amen. He is worthy to be praised.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. Worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Standing on the promises, and Pastor wanted me to remind you that since we're not sitting on the premises, we're going to be standing on the promises. So that's his joke. If you're going to write in, hashtag Pastor Mike on that.
Good morning, church. It's so good to see you, or actually not see you. I'm glad you're seeing me. How's that? Thank you for being here. Thank you for joining us. Man, we are living in strange times, aren't we? These are unbelievably strange days. Yesterday, I was asked to preach a funeral, unfortunately, and it was just really strange. The funeral director was telling me all of the changes that they were having to go through, and they only allowed 10 people at the graveside. That was it. And no tent, no chairs, nothing, just 10 people standing out there in the open air. And it was just really different. It was really strange. It's strange, but in some ways it's also good, the things that are going on. There's a lot getting done at our house lately. And, Lynette has this to-do list. She writes it down, but she doesn't share it with me. I think she has the to-do list and has it written down. But we are slowly going through her to-do list. And that's a good thing. How many of y'all live by to-do lists out there? Some people do, some people don't. You know, one of the positive things that has come as a result of this social distancing is that I've seen many of you getting things done in your house besides me. And some things that you have put off in the past are now becoming things that get accomplished. You know, time management folks tell us that a to-do list is a good thing. It's a great way to keep track of and prioritize the things that need to accomplish. And the benefit of these lists is that it gives you a target. It gives you a goal in black and white that you can look at, that you can visibly see that you're actually getting things done. But there's also a bad side to to-do lists as well. Because many times there's so many things on your to-do list that you see what you're not accomplishing also. And the unfinished to-do lists happen a lot, I think. And not because the tasks weren't important, but it's because life is unpredictable in many ways. And you can't anticipate everything that happens. You have this list of what you'd like to accomplish, but sometimes life gets in the way. And we can't stop interruptions or demands that other people place upon our lives. But I have a question for you this morning. How do you respond when other people get in your way? How do you react when other people put priorities on you and it takes away from maybe what you want to accomplish? How do you react in every situation in your life that's completely out of your hands? I think today is a good example of that. How are you reacting in this situation? Are you full of joy? I was reading in Scripture just a short time ago before I came up here. And in Psalm chapter 5, in verse 11, it says, "But let those rejoice who have their trust in you." I wonder if we do that. Let those rejoice who have trust in you. Even in these days and times, can you rejoice because your trust is in Him? I believe that Jesus is concerned about your reactions. Today's sermon is being distinct in my reactions. How do I react in different situations in life? Because the way you react in irritating and frustrating situations, things that are out of your control, the way that you react will either prove who you are in Christ or disprove who you say you are in Christ. Again, Jesus points directly at the heart in Matthew chapter 5, where we've been spending our time on the Sermon on the Mount. He's speaking to the heart in all of these things. And again, he does the same thing as we look at beginning in verse 33. He calls us to a standard that is consistent. He calls us to a standard that is honest in our dealings with other people. He calls us to be filled with grace in every situation. Matthew chapter 5, beginning in verse 33, we read this. Again, you have heard it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform to the Lord what you have sworn. But I say to you, do not take an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not take an oath by your head, for you cannot make one hair black or white, or put a hair on your head. Let what you say be simply, verse 37, yes or no. Anything more than this comes from evil. You have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone would sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him too. Give to the one who begs from you, and do not refuse the one who would borrow from you. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word, and I thank you how we can examine our own hearts against the standard of your word. Lord, today as we come to you, I just pray that we would look at ourselves in the mirror of the gospel. How do we interact with others? How do we act in front of others? How do we act when things are out of our hands? Lord, I pray that we would be the church, that we would love others as you have loved us. In your name I pray. Amen. The first point that I want to make today or ask you is, it's a question, what is in a promise? I think that's what Jesus gets to. The point that Jesus gets to is what is in a promise? You know, we've all felt, I think, the pain of a broken promise. We've all felt the pain of a broken commitment. We've all had our own share of failure to keep commitments to others as well. For those who take words seriously, I think it hurts both ways. It hurts when we don't receive the promise that other people make. And I believe that if you take your words seriously, it hurts you when you can't keep a promise. Or it should. In verses 33 through 37, Jesus forces us to examine our own integrity through the lens of promise making. When you look at the Old Testament law, you find repeated instruction to keep your own word, to be absolutely truthful. But by Jesus' time, people were making distinctions in their promises, and Jesus points that out here. They're making distinctions in their and taking oaths. Some were very serious, and others not so serious by their standards. If someone, for example, made a promise using God's name, he was bringing God into the promise, so to speak. And so they were making a very serious promise. I think many people do that today when they say things like, I swear to God, not realizing the seriousness of what they're saying. But if someone simply gave his word on a matter, they gave their word by their own head, Jesus says, it was considered less serious in nature. Jesus made a point to say that, though, that the God is always involved when a follower of Christ gives his word or her word. God's always involved. It doesn't matter if you say, I swear to God, or if I swear by my own head, or if I swear by anything. Don't swear by anything, because God is involved in the word of a believer. When you give your word, when you give a promise, when you make an oath, take an oath to do something, Jesus says that God is in it if you're a follower of his. God's presence is always with a believer. And when you tell somebody that I will do something, they are taking it as if God himself, through you, are talking to them if you say that you're a believer. You've heard people say it all the time. Well, if that person's a Christian and they're living like this, or they're saying this and then they do this, then I don't need to be a Christian. The name of God goes with you in every situation, even making promises. As you give your word, there's two things that I want you to consider. First, be careful what you commit to. Be careful what you commit to. Many of us have a tendency, I think, to overcommit ourselves. We have the best intentions, I think, but at some point, we have to realize that a to-do list can only be so long. There's only 24 hours in a day. You can only do so many things. And I think we need to learn that no is a legitimate response. I can't do that. I don't have the time to do that, or something else has priority here, and I cannot make that commitment. So many of us want to make other people so happy all the time that we will say yes to anything. And instead of keeping your word, you end up breaking the promise. I think it's legitimate to say no. You know, I just can't do that right now. There's other things here that need to take priority. The second thing that I want to remind you of as you make a promise is keep your word when you give it. Keep your word when you give it. God honors the person who keeps his word, whatever the cost, according to Psalm 15:4. He honors the person who keeps his word, whatever the cost. Unforeseen circumstances can pop up and make it difficult to keep some promises. It's going to happen. When that happens, you need to communicate with the person that you made the promise to and give an alternate idea for completion of that promise. Hey, something came up. I can't keep the promise that I made you, that I made to you today. However, let me offer this as an alternate. Let me follow up. Let me let you know that I still am concerned about keeping my word, but something came up and I can't do it. We fail to communicate many times when we can't keep our promises. And it's not just a blemish on your name, it's a blemish on God's name when you do that. I think that that's the point that Jesus is making here. However, once we give our word, even if it hurts us to do so, we need to keep our word. Why? Because the scripture says, keeping your word pleases God. Keeping your word pleases God. Don't take your promises lightly. Inevitably, you and I will feel the pain of a promise that wasn't kept. You know, there's a lot of things in my house that need to be done. And I tell Lynette, yeah, I'll do them. But you know what? She doesn't have to remind me every 6 months that it needs to be done. That was supposed to be funny. I hope you laughed. But, yeah, I need to do what I say that I will do. We don't need to take our promises lightly. Inevitably, you and I, like I said, will feel that pain of a promise that wasn't kept. So the question is, what do you do when that happens? How do you react when a promise is not kept? Do you make a little tick mark on your in your brain and file it away somewhere to bring it back up later? Or maybe even look for an opportunity to get back at the person and treat them with the same disrespect that they treated you with? Is that how you react when somebody doesn't keep a promise to you? You see, Jesus doesn't let us off the hook even if we're on the receiving end of a bad promise. Jesus expects grace given because grace was given to you as well. And Jesus, as a matter of fact, he turns from making promises to revenge in this passage of Scripture. I don't think that there's a mistake there. I don't think that's an error. I think it was planned by Jesus to immediately go into revenge. Because he says, you have heard it said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. In other words, you don't keep your promises to me, so I'm not going to keep my promises to you. How do you react when somebody breaks a promise? The way you react will show who you are in Christ. The second point that I want to make today is in verses 38 through 39. The question there is, what is your right? What is our right? The Old Testament records this eye for an eye law three times. That's why Jesus says, you have heard it said, an eye for an eye. It records it in Exodus 21, 23 through 24. It records it in Leviticus 24, 19 and 20. And also in Deuteronomy 19, 21. The eye for an eye law. But the intention of this law was being surpassed in Jesus' day. God's intention of this law was to limit vengeance, not to give license for vengeance. You need to write that down. That's good. God's intention for the eye for an eye law was to limit vengeance, not to give license to vengeance. The law was meant to make sure that conflict didn't escalate. And the intent was that vengeance be kept within specific boundaries. Furthermore, the wronged individual was never to seek justice or vengeance on his own. Instead, the law served as a guide for judges as they decided appropriate punishments through the court proceedings. Jesus, as he so often does, reorders our thinking here. He tells those that follow him that they're not to retaliate when we are humiliated or insulted. You're not to retaliate when a promise is not kept. You and I are kind of born with this self-defense mechanism, aren't we? When somebody wrongs us, what is the first thing that we want to do? We want to wrong them back. We want to get back at them. We want them to pay for whatever it is that they have done to us. We want them to feel the pain that we feel. We have this built-in mechanism. That's human nature, isn't it? When we begin to follow Jesus, we're instructed by Jesus. We should follow Him. And we should follow Scripture. What we're in, once we begin to follow Jesus, we're in a fight against human nature. We take on a godly nature, a different nature. We put on the name of Christ as we say that we will follow Him. And our nature changes, or it should change. Our reactions to other people, even in the midst of being wronged, should be indicative of the name of Christ. And the question that I have today is it? Are you a do you take revenge on people? Or are you biding your time right now, waiting for the opportunity to take revenge? What are our rights here? You know, the other person should know that they have been in interaction with a Christ follower. When there's a conflict, when they don't keep their promise, when they slight you in some way, we should come out on the other side of the confrontation being distinct in our reaction. And the question is, how many times has this happened as you recall the times when you were in the middle of a confrontation that you failed to reveal Christ? That there was no indication that you were different from anybody else at all. How many times have we failed in that regard in our reactions with other people? Do people want what you have after you've been in some type of confrontation with them? Or do people want to flee from you? Do you offer grace? Or do you offer revenge? It's difficult, isn't it? It's hard. It's being a Christ follower. And it's not easy. Many of us use Matthew 18:20 to declare that God is present in small group Bible studies. You know, Matthew 18:20, where it says, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them." We use that as a, like in a situation like this. Well, our numbers are few, but where two or more are gathered, there Jesus is with them. And we get all fuzzy and filly about that, and we're great about that. But actually, that's not the context in which Jesus makes that statement. He's not saying, okay, in a small group situation, I'm there, so let's all hug and sing Kumbaya. If you look at Matthew 18, what is the context of this verse that Jesus reminds us, "For where two or more are gathered in my name, there I am among them"? The context is within conflict. The real context of this verse is, if you're having a disagreement with a fellow believer, it would serve you well to remember that God is right there with you. That's the context. You read Matthew 18 and it gives you the steps to take within conflict. And then it says, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them." In the midst of your disagreement, if you are a Christ follower, you need to remember that God is there, that God is present, that the way you react in this situation is an indicator if you are a true follower or not. What is the instruction that Jesus gives us in the Sermon on the Mount regarding the way that we should react to others? Well, Jesus instructs his followers to deny themselves. He instructs his followers to deny your rights. How easy is that? How easy is it to just deny the fact that, hey, what am I, mincemeat? You know, I mean, who do you think you are talking to me like that? How easy is it to deny your rights? People usually believe they have something coming to them when they've been wronged. But that's not the instruction that Jesus gives. He tells us to deny our rights. He tells us to follow Him on the road of forgiveness, to follow Him on the road of self-denial. So deny yourself your rights. The second thing that He tells us is to deny ourselves of our entitlement. Very close to our rights is our entitlement. Some things spring up from inside us, I think, in the midst of these conflicts to say that says, I deserve better than this. But any feeling of entitlement fails to recognize that all we are truly entitled to is death and hell, in reality. Because of our own actions. You see, the Bible says that we were born enemies of God. That we are not entitled to really anything when it comes to eternal life. We experience God's mercy. We experience God's forgiveness because we come to Him and we find Him willing to offer us grace in the midst of a conflict, in the midst of breaking promises. We come to Him and we say, God, I am so sorry. I failed. I haven't kept my promise. And does God make tick marks waiting for the opportunity to get back at us? Does God file that back in His memory and say, you just wait? When we come to Him, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We find Him willing to offer us grace, and it's not because we're entitled to it at all. Then Jesus says, not only are we to deny our rights, not only are we to deny our entitlement, but then He says, also deny your pride. Man, this is really getting bad, isn't it? I don't have any rights, I don't have any entitlement, and now Jesus wants to take away my pride. The worst part of the whole experience of being wronged by someone is the blow we receive to our ego. We feel completely humiliated and we feel damaged deep within ourselves. And that's where Jesus hits, deep within us. And He attacks our pride. Followers of Jesus must let go of their pride and inflated ego in favor of following Him on the path of humility. Where did I get that from? Well, turn in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 2. We're to follow Christ on the path of humility. Philippians chapter 2, beginning in verse 5, it says, have this mind among yourselves. In other words, think this way. This is how you are to think. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. What's he saying here? In other words, if you are in Christ, this is the way that you should be thinking. Verse 6 says, who, though he was the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. But made himself what? Nothing. Made himself nothing. taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. I don't think too many of us are willing to do that. We're full of ego. We're full of my rights. We're full of my entitlement. So how far do we go? My third point. How far do we go? Verses 40 through 42. As if it wasn't enough to not seek revenge when somebody wrongs us, Jesus went on to say that we should go the extra mile to make the other person know that he's loved. Go the extra mile with them. Isn't it strange that he even tells us to do this for those that take advantage of us? To go the extra mile for those who even take advantage of us. That's just not right. Why should I do that? Why should I give up all of this? You and I need to think of obedience in terms of what we tend to do, is we tend to think of obedience in terms of minimums. What is the minimum I must do to be obedient? What is the minimum that I can do and still be in the right? We've been programmed that way even since school. You know, you didn't do this, but I did. What can I get away with not doing and still pass this class? What's the minimum that I can do to make it through? And we tend to carry that with us the rest of our lives. What is the minimum that I can do and still be a Christian? Still be a follower of Christ? What is the minimum that I can do and still be called a follower of His? And we're okay with that. What we do is we set the bar low and celebrate the achievement of it. We set the bar low and we say, look at how good I am, how great I am, how good things are going in my path to follow Him. But what Jesus does is He takes that bar that we set here and He moves it up to here and He says, this is the goal, not this. The minimalist in us reveals who we are really on the inside. And there goes Jesus again, digging into our heart. The minimalist mindset shows a heart that is out of touch with the grace of God. God has lavished us with undeserved, unmerited, overwhelming grace. And Jesus' point is that we shouldn't focus on the minimum. Instead, we should focus on how we can be a blessing to even those who wrong us. Go the extra mile, above and beyond. And it takes more than willpower to do that. It takes God power to do that. I can't do it. It takes faith in a God that forgives all sin to do that. But in order to do this, we need three things. First one is believe that God will provide. We need to have a belief that God will provide. Going the extra mile is costly. It costs you something to go the extra mile for somebody. In every case, especially in a case where somebody has wronged you. And that's the case that Jesus is talking about here in Matthew. Go the extra mile for the person that has wronged you. It's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you some money. It's going to cost you some time. It's going to cost you some pride. It's going to cost you some ego. It's going to cost you something to go the extra mile for somebody. And we have to believe that God will provide the coat that He says to give them. That God will provide the money that it takes to make it right. Or that God will provide the time that we have given up for the sake of someone else. We have to believe that God will provide. The second thing that we have to do in order to go the extra mile is to believe that God will rectify. You know, when we give sacrificially for the sake of someone else, we might be tempted to treat it like a loan. We might be tempted to say, I'm going to give this, but I expect something back. I expect maybe something in return. I expect your kindness in return. I expect your gratitude in return. I expect to get a card in the mail saying how much you are thankful for what was provided. I expect something in return for my generosity. But we shouldn't. We have to give with the belief that God will set everything right in the end. Why do you give your rights away? Why do we give our entitlement away? Why do we give our privilege away? Because we're to be Christ. In every situation, in every reaction. When you do that, you can go the extra mile without the expectation of payback. When you put Christ first, trust God in the midst of every situation, even conflict. Trust God. Because God is the one who sees what you've done. And God is the one who sees who you are on the inside. And God is the one who knows if you are waiting for the opportunity to take revenge. And God is the one who measures your heart. The third thing and last thing, not only do we need to believe that God will provide, not only do we believe need to believe that God will rectify, but we need to believe that God will redeem. What if we go the extra mile for somebody and nothing happens? What if the other person doesn't recognize our efforts at all? What if it goes unnoticed? We might be tempted to become bitter. We might be tempted to become resentful. We made all this effort and it's not even recognized. I'm working my tail off here and nobody's even knowing it. I'm doing all of this. I'm giving and giving and giving. And God, I just can't give anymore. We might be tempted to become resentful toward that person. Or those people. We may wish that we've never even made an effort at all. What's it all worth? Nobody's even noticing. But listen, God is the Redeemer. God is the one who redeems. Though it all might seem like a waste here and now, we trust, you have to trust, God in His wisdom and in His power to redeem what we've done for His good purposes. What you're doing is representing Christ. You're not representing yourself at all. So don't get angry when nobody recognizes it. Listen. How many people live daily as if Christ has done nothing at all? And yet the Bible still says that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever will just believe, if they'll just believe, they will receive eternal life. Though it all may seem like a waste here and now, we trust God in His wisdom and in His power to redeem what we've done for His good purposes. When we become distinct in our reactions to others, what Jesus is saying here is that it glorifies God and accelerates the promise of the gospel. Why go the extra mile even for our enemies, even when they don't even recognize us? Why? Because it accelerates the gospel. You are a representative of the name of Christ. When I say on a weekly basis, be the church, this is what I'm talking about. Be the church, be Christ. Be distinct in the way that you react in every situation. When somebody comes out on the other side of a confrontation, they need to know that they came face to face with Christ in the midst of that. They received grace when they should have received punishment. Jesus' command to go the extra mile is countercultural to our society today. Doesn't make sense. Why should we do that? We should do it because Christ Himself is distinct. And so should we be. Let's pray. Father God, I know this is a difficult message to hear. How in the world can we love others the way that You have loved us? Seems impossible. But God, all things are possible through Christ. Lord, I pray today for those individuals that are listening that have been wronged in so many ways. And God, I'm not denying the pain of being wronged. It's very real. But I believe that You share the same pain. I believe that we're not alone in our pain. Lord, I pray that the people that are listening that have been wronged will recognize that they're to represent Christ in every situation. That it's a matter of the heart. And God, I'm not justifying the wrong. We're not justifying it at all. But we are declaring that in Christ we can still be the church. Lord, today I want to pray for the individual who's listening who may not know You. and they see a trail of destruction in their life because of the decisions that they've made. And God, if they would have heeded this advice that I've given you, that they would have people involved in their life even now that have been separated because of some rift. They've alienated themselves because they have not been living the name of Christ. They can't live the name of Christ because they don't have Christ in their life. Lord, I pray today that they would listen to your word. Your word that tells us that greater love hath no one than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend. Your word that tells us that we've all sinned and we've all fallen short of the glory of God. We've all wronged you. And yet your word tells us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Lord, I pray today that you would penetrate the heart of that man, that woman, that child that's listening. Help them to know that they can live a better life in Christ. That there is joy found in your salvation. If you're listening and you know you need Christ, you can do that right where you're sitting, whether it's at your desk in your office or whether it's in your home, whether it's in the car even as you're listening. You can come to God and He will forgive you. He will give you the grace that He's talked about in His Word, as we talked about. He will go the extra mile for you. And He did, by sending His Son. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Won't you do that today? As I preached that funeral yesterday, it was obvious that many of those around had made some bad decisions. God doesn't want to convict you. God wants to love you. And there's a better life in Christ. Won't you come? Won't you come home to Him? Let me lead you in a prayer right now, where you're sitting. You can pray something like this: God, I recognize that I am a sinner, and I've wronged you in many ways. And God, I come to you today, and I place my faith and my trust in the fact that Jesus died for my sins. And Lord, all that I am, I want to give to you. God, I give you my heart and I will follow you wherever you lead. I give you my life. Lead me in the way that you would have me go. God's word says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. I believe that's true. It's true for you. It's true for me. Trust in God today. If you are a person that has been waiting to take revenge, even as a follower of Christ, let it go. Let it go. Let Christ shine through. Allow the other person to know that they've dealt with Christ Himself in the midst of this conflict. Because where two or three are gathered, He's there too. We're going to sing. I just pray that you'll make it right with God in every situation today.
All the stories ever told, all the songs the world could hold, not a single one comes close to tell you what's inside my soul. How sweet it is, how sweet it is, how sweet it is to be loved by Jesus. How sweet it is, how sweet it is, how sweet it is to be loved by you. The measure of your love so deep can fill the tide of every sea. Nothing else in history compares to what you've done for me. How sweet it is, how sweet it is, how sweet it is to be loved by Jesus. How sweet it is, how sweet it is. How sweet it is to be loved by you, by you, Lord. How sweet it is, how sweet it is. I'm loved by you, Lord. How sweet it is, how sweet. Will burn its final flame, and every tear be wiped away. When I see you face to face, forevermore my heart will sing. Oh, how sweet it is, how sweet it is. How sweet it is to be loved by Jesus. How sweet it is, how sweet it is, how sweet it is to be loved by you. How sweet it is, how sweet it is, how sweet it is to be Jesus. How sweet it is, how sweet it is, how sweet it is to be loved by you.
Amen. Well, glad we've had the time to worship with you this morning. I'll continue to pray for each other. Again, if you have a need, be sure and let the office know. We want to help any way that we can. We love you, and go and be the church.